as the enforcement directorate continues its crackdown on Gitanjali Group companies. Around 5,000 Gitanjali employees fired across cities. Top officials of Nirav Modi's company also put in their papers.
Only an allegation. It is only an allegation which would be defended. It is only an allegation. Nothing more than that.
It started to be the India's biggest banking scam, but Nirav Modi's lawyer claims there is no fraud. In an exclusive conversation, he says Nirav was out of the country for business purposes and not on the run. Medical report confirms the assault on Delhi Chief Secretary. Two AAP MLAs accused of assaulting the bureaucrat arrested, sent to judicial custody, but no word yet from CM Kejriwal on the entire matter. Rajasthan government cracks down on farmers demanding better pricing for their produce. 20 farmer leaders arrested ahead of their scheduled protests at the state assembly tomorrow. In just a short while from now, Tamil superstar Kamal Hassan will make his grand entry on Tamil Nadu's political arena. Citizens, get ready to say Vanakam Neta Kamal. Kamal Hassan's whirlwind political tour kicks off with a visit to former President Kalam's residence. Actor-turned-Neta also meets fishermen in Rameshwaram, says serving people my top priority. Harassed allegedly by personal attacks of corporators, Thane Municipal Corporation Chief Sanjeev Jaiswal urges the State Assembly to pass a no-confidence vote against him so that the government is forced to transfer him. All right, let's get some breaking news coming in. Now, the government mulls to crack down on defaulters. The government is likely to restrict foreign travel of defaulters and planning to crack down on loan defaulters. That's the latest details that we're getting, that this is in light of the entire Nirav Modi scam that has broken out recently. Now, the government is mulling, cracking down on defaulters altogether and restricting their foreign travel altogether. That's the latest that we are picking up. We will try and get more details on this. Essentially, this plan is to restrict the foreign travel, to scrutinize abnormal increase in overseas transactions. That's what we are picking up. Remember, this is after Nirav Modi is no longer in the country in light of this entire scam that has broken out of late. The enforcement wing of the Reserve Bank of India. All right, let's go across to Tanvi for more details. Tanvi, what are the details? Can you tell us about this?
Well, actually, it's very preliminary right now, Avni. We only know from our network sources that the government is considering steps to ensure that, you know, the willful defaulters and big defaulters on their loans do not get to travel abroad so easily. You know, one would have used the saying once bitten, twice shy, but that's obviously not the case here, because we have more than one cases where similar things have happened, from Vijay Mallya to now Nirav Modi, where people who've been, their companies have been buried under a huge amount of debt, have actually managed to get out of the country before the investigative agencies have woken up to what was really happening on ground. So now we understand that perhaps the center will look at certain steps, you know, certain rules and regulations. In fact, just a few days ago, there was a lot of, voices on social media, including senior reporters and editors like Tamal Bandyopadhyay. And I remember Tamal Bandyopadhyay talking about the fact that perhaps people who have large loans and are willful defaulters, their passports should be seized. So, that, you know, people are already beginning to question this and demand this. So it's good that the government is considering this. Of course, it will probably not help us anymore as far as getting Nirav Modi or Vijay Mallya back is concerned. But it could help us in ensuring that perhaps another Rotomak Kothari cannot run away. And that these people are there on the radar and aren't able to escape without paying up to the banks, Avni.
Absolutely, Tanvi. Thanks for getting us those details. So this is just an initial coming, the point that's coming in, say that this might come through. The government is mulling this at this point, and as Tanvi says, it's not going to help us with Nirav Modi, but perhaps in the future it will prevent loan defaulters from escaping out of the country. And in fact, as Nirav Modi loot snowballs, Mirror Now has accessed the list of willful defaulters. This is a 372-page list which names companies, all of whom who have been termed as willful defaulters by different banks. Put together, these companies have looted India of a jaw-dropping 1,11,738 crores. Aishwarya gets us details that she has accessed. All right, we'll try and get you more details on that. But at this point, that's what we have, that we have a list of willful defaulters, which is a list of 372 pages, several companies, number of them, all of whom have been termed as willful defaulters by different banks. And these companies, in fact, have looted India of as much as 1,11,738 crores. Tanvi is back for more on this. Tanvi, 1,11,738 crores, that's the amount that India has been looted of.
Yes, and this is just a list of, you know, the top willful defaulters. Avni, also very essential to make out the difference between defaulters and willful defaulters. Willful defaulters is a tag given to those who can actually afford to repay but are still not doing so under the excuse of the business going down or the economy not doing well or whatever else. But companies and promoters who have the money to pay back but will not do so. Several years ago, actually, even during UPS era, there was this entire trend that had begun of naming and shaming these people, these companies, calling them willful defaulters, forcing them to sell off their assets. I remember a lot of these properties were seized. They were put on auction. They were put under the hammer. There were voices that were raised saying that, you know, even if they need to sell the personal silver jewelry off these promoters, that should be done. So we have accessed a list of these 10 defaulters. And if you look at the amount, that gives you a sense of how much money our state banks have actually lost because of these people, because of these companies, because of their promoters who have not managed to give this money back. Now, you can attach some properties and go around running, following the procedure to reclaim some of your money back. But at the end of the day, there are massive write-offs. Banks are losing money quarter after quarter. They're talking about these massive write-offs, Avni, that you're also very well aware of. And that is nothing but taxpayers' money that is going down the drain.
Right. Tanvi, can you take us through what kind of, which are some of these companies and what kind of quantums are we talking about?
So, broadly, between 100 crores to about 1,000 crores, there are multiple jewelry companies in this list. The list is actually also now playing out for us. There was Winsome Diamonds that went under with about 4,000 crore of debt. There is an SFIR investigation that is actually going on against Winsome Diamonds and its promoter Jatin Mehta, who, by the way, we understand the last time we checked several months ago, was also out of the country. So there is no wrongdoing that has been claimed or found by the court, but the investigation is on, again, a promoter who's out of the country. Surya Vinayak Industries, NMC, several other jewelers, these are some of the companies who have taken loans. And if you see the trend, Avni, most of these defaulters have actually taken larger size loans from Punjab National Bank or any other state-owned bank. So it's the state-owned banks who ended up taking a larger hit, which is why questions are raised about whether they don't have a good enough strong system in place. The government is now trying to say that people like Jatin Mehta, people like Vijay Mallya shouldn't be allowed to get away, and if they're planning to go abroad, then perhaps there need to be some restrictions on their travel plans. Avni, I believe we've got Saloni Shukla of Economic Times with us. She's got some more details on the story that we're breaking.
Yes, let's go across to Saloni Shukla, who's joining us on the phone line. Saloni, what more details can you get for us in this entire issue right now that we're tracking?
So what we've picked so far is the fact that these are informal discussions which have happened with the government and the Reserve Bank of India and the Financial Intelligence Unit. And, you know, what they're clearly trying to do is that they have studied past defaults, okay, I mean, if you look at what happened in the Vijay Mallya matter, or what happened with Nirav Modi, or what happened with Jatin Mehta, or what is happening in the Sterling Biotech case. All these promoters, they fled the country, and there was this history of a huge outward remittance in terms of property and their dealings of, you know, getting, you know, out of this country. So now what they're doing is they're trying to restrict. This is early stages, but this is under planning. They're saying that they would look at foreign travel of some of these defaulters who are unwilling to pay despite repeated risks. Also, since the Reserve Bank of India is the prime authority for controlling all these capital flows inside and outside the country, the RBI has raised both, you know, these remittances of both individuals and companies. So that will be tracked on a, you know, like a day, you know, on a quarterly basis. And obviously, it will be done by the enforcement wing of the Reserve Bank, which was set up last year. So this is what we are hearing so far. Back to you.
Right. Salona, do we have any sort of a timeline, any kind of more details as to how and how this entire thing is actually going to be implemented and what sort of timeline, if at all, that we're looking at this point?
But what we've learned is that the Home Ministry had flagged off this issue, and that is when the Finance Ministry kind of swung into action, and they have taken RBI and FIU, the Financial Intelligence Unit, on board. So obviously, this is developing. They are on the back foot right now because of what has happened in the Nirav Modi case, and they want to be seen as proactive. So obviously, you would expect something on this soon. What we are learning is that announcement on this could be very soon. Back to you.
All right. Thanks, Saloni, for getting us all those details. All right. We've also joining us right now is Ravindra Gupta on the phone line. Thank you very much, Mr. Gupta, for joining in. What is your sense of this latest development that we're seeing where the, you know, they're mulling, restricting foreign travel of loan defaulters?
Can you please repeat the last line again?
The restriction of travel, foreign travel specifically, as far as loan defaulters are concerned, how are you viewing that?
The first point is that the willful defaulters have the means to repay the bank's outstanding loans, and they are not paying. So this is one of the major points. And the RBI took so many months to declare the name of the willful defaulters. And willful defaulters are eating away the most of the capital and the profits of the banking industry. There are about huge 80 big willful defaulters. Those are basically contributing the entire major the chunk of NPA in the banking system. The way these enforcement agencies have acted against the Nirav Modi, they raided, they seized the assets of this kind of approach needed from the Indian authorities as on date. Basically, the law should be very stringent. The foreign travel, stopping the foreign travel, okay, that is a good move at this moment. At least they cannot cross over the border, because after that, that treaties between the two countries are preventing them to come to the our own land, and at least the proceedings can be immediately started against that. But again, this is a criminal activity, willful default, because the entire banking they have been destroying as on date. And really, that law of the land, at least there should be some amendment, and very stringent kind of criminal activity must be.
Absolutely, Mr. Gupta. The fact is that this is a much, much deeper rooted problem, as is being pointed out time and again, that this is a very deep rooted problem, especially as far as public sector banks are concerned. And that itself is something that needs to be addressed at a much deeper level.
No doubt. What you said is very, very correct. Basically, that the writing of the loans of the defaulters in the banking system, and this willful defaulter, basically they need to be handled very strongly, because in the coming days, otherwise the entire banking system will collapse, and they are taking the advantage of the laws. So I will definitely watch that law should be more stringent to book all these culprits, and it will be a demonstrative effect for the others. That is, you put a willful defaulter 2 days behind the bar, definitely the recovery will start because they are taking the advantage of the law, isn't it?
And this figure that, you know, in fact, Mr. Kutat Mehra has accessed a list of willful defaulters, which is a 372-page list. And that number that we've got hold of is 1,11,738 crores that we're talking about, that from these willful defaulters that have actually looted the country. That's the figure that we're talking about.
Yeah, no doubt, because the major willful default as well as an NPA are in the big corporates, because small type of NPAs, that agriculture NPA, SME sector NPA, they have no value. But so if we are able to catch hold the big willful defaulters and some law to be amended, then definitely that recovery will fasten, and they have the means to pay, their assets must be immediately seized. And at least the government can run those factories or the industry at their own also, to be given to somebody else, because this is a sort of sickness that is spreading all over, because the level of the NPA has gone up many folds in the last 4, 5, 6 years.
Absolutely.
This is a big problem that need to be immediately checked.
Absolutely. All right. Thank you very much, Ramzi Gupta, for joining us with your perspective. That's right. Well, the wait is finally over. Superstar Kamal Hassan will make his big political debut today with the formal launch of his party. The actor will announce the name of his party and also unveil his party flag in Madurai. Earlier today, Kamal met fishermen at Ganesh Mahal of Rameshwaram. This after he began his whirlwind political tour by visiting former President APJ Abdul Kalam's residence in Rameshwaram as well. Mrunal, of course, is tracking every step of Neta Kamal's political journey, and we will get you more details as well on this entire thing. But at this point, superstar Kamal Hassan will make his big political debut today, in a short while from now. In fact, he's going to address for the first time going to make his first political address. This is happening in Madurai, and this, in fact, those are the visuals there on your screens of the kind of welcome that he has been receiving. The actor will announce the name of his party and unveil his party flag as well. He also met fishermen at Rameshwaram, and he also began his political tour by visiting former President APJ Abdul Kalam's residence in Rameshwaram as well. The big question that is, of course, being looked out for now is whether his entire fan base, there's a lot of, he got a rousing welcome as far as his fans are concerned, but whether his fan base will turn into his voter base is something that we really need to wait and watch. And also the fact that Rajinikanth is also entering the political Tamil Nadu political arena, how will both these factors really work out? How will that change the landscape as far as Tamil Nadu's politics are concerned, is something that we also have to watch out for. How ready are, or how much do people really want a change? How frustrated are they with the current state of affairs in the state? How badly do they want an alternative? All these things, all these questions will be answered only going forward. And of course, only time will tell. Of course, Tamil Nadu has been going through a lot of political turmoil of late, ever since Jayalalitha's death. And now with both Rajinikanth and Kamal Hassan entering the fray here, we'll of course have to wait and see how this entire thing pans out. Of course, Kamal Hassan also hinted at his recent speech in Harvard. He did hint at that his focus will essentially be on what the people of Tamil Nadu really need, specifically on developmental politics. That's where his focus is going to lie. But more specifics are, of course, awaited. That's what people are looking out for, waiting to hear more specifics in terms of what he's going to focus on, where his key areas will be, how is he going to actually live up to his promises that he's been talking about off late. Of course, he has been saying that the way things are being handled in Tamil Nadu is not good at all, and that really needs to change. And that is where he's going to focus on. We'll of course have to watch out for his speech is expected to start shortly, his first political speech. We'll get more details on that. Let's also take a look at some reactions that have been coming in on this.
First off, like, I've been a fan of Kamal Hassan for more than 40 years now. I followed him since 1977. And with the launch of his political party, I mean, it's going to transform the way Tamil Nadu politics is going to function. And I just want to be here to support what he's trying to do for the betterment of Tamil Nadu. And that's my only motive.
And you came all the way from UK?
That's correct, yes. I came on Saturday. And I've been part of the Fans Association as well from 1985. So I know a lot of the people here that's going to be here. And so it's a proud moment for Tamil Nadu.
See, today is an historic day for the people of Tamil Nadu and the state in general. Because for the past 1 year, the state administration is in a limbo and the whole state is in a paralyzed mode. So people are desperately wanting to change the situation because they are put in so much of hardship and they want somebody to lead them for the future, the future generations. It has become a question mark for every citizen of Tamil Nadu. So Namavar Mr. Kamal Hassan wants every individual person to come to the center. That is the Mayam which he speaks about.
Something good I want to happen in Tamil Nadu.
And you have been part of the bureaucratic machinery, you have been part of the government machinery. Do you think that Kamal Hassan will be able to make a change? Yes. In terms of governance?
Yes, I believe that he can make a change, make a difference.
And you are taking care of Kamal Hassan's security, and how hectic this day is?
Yes, it is hectic. A lot of enthusiastic crowd we have to manage.
And what about the security arrangements in Madurai, sir? How many people are expected today? And what are the kind of arrangements that you have put in place from your side?
So we have engaged volunteers. About 200, we have engaged professional security people and we have requested local police also to help us.
It's not a specific mention. If at all, specifically he mentioned in this scheme, we would react to that. We would respond to that. Totally saying this means it's a baseless.
So now at this point in time, how do you think his political career will pan out? Because already you see the DMK already has taken a jibe at him. Would you say that he will have a strong political career ahead of him?
Definitely in Tamil Nadu, our party will stand yesterday, today and ever. So no party will come to Tamil Nadu. No party will serve in Tamil Nadu. Okay.
So overall at this point in time, even Rajinikanth is going to come to the fray. Two big actors are going to enter. You don't have Jay Jalalitha anymore. No big face in the AIDMK. There's a lot of differences within your party. Do you think that these two can make a big political difference?
You're only saying a difference opinion in our party. No difference opinion party. We are all together. We're running party smoothly. We're running government smoothly. No issues. If at all Rajinikanth, Kamal, whoever comes, we don't worry with them.
Everybody, see, in India, the constitution permits everyone to have a free view. So Kamal Hassan is starting a party, we cannot stop him. What we will do is, after starting his party, we will look into his principles. What is his ideology? If his ideology is opposed to us, we will oppose, that's all.
So is there any, already there's been some same wavelength of Dravidian cultures and ideologies between DMK and...
Yes, but let him spell out the policies of his party.
The Kamal Hassan, all on a sudden after 60 years of age, Rajinikanth and Kamal Hassan, now they are showing a keen interest in politics. But if you see, for anybody comes into politics, I am 65 years old. From student days itself, I have a keen interest in politics. Nearly 40-50 years of political career I have. But you must have interest in your blood, in your outlook, everything. All and a sudden, after 6 years, after their retiring stage in the cine field, these actors are getting more involved in politics. I don't know how they are going to perform.
தாய்மொழி தினமாக கொண்டாட வேண்டும் என்று அறிவித்தது. 2000 ஆண்டு கால பழமையும் இலக்கணமும் இலக்கியமும் பண்பாட்டு சிறப்பும் மிக்க எமது தாய்மொழியான அமிழ்தினும் இனிய தெய்வங்கள் பேசியதால் பிழைத்த மொழிகள் இந்த உலகத்திலே உண்டு. தான் பிழைத்திருப்பதற்காக தெய்வமே என்னை தமிழால் பாடுக என்று கேட்ட மொழியின் தினத்தில் நாம் இங்கே கூடியிருக்கிறோம்.
All right, that's the live, what you can hear, visuals from Madurai at this point. In short while from now, Kamal Hassan will make his first political speech and announce the name of his party. We'll, of course, be tracking all those details for you right here on Mirror Now.